just gonna take a deep breath for a while. Okay, I should start.
Okay, how are you, by the way? Are you guys?
It's the numbers are getting, you know. Have anyone look at the slides? We're gonna look at the tendency for the profits to fall. So our numbers are like that. In a way, they have this tendency to fall, but then it just go up again, but then falling down even lower. Just crazy and amazing at the same time. Okay, I mean, what are you guys having now at the moment? I was told you guys are basically like Simon Weeks of some sort. That's why I'm not trying to justify why the numbers are low, but I assume that contributes to why the numbers are as it is today. There's a couple of things that we're going to do today, in a way, but before that, I want to share a few stories that I kind of have collected when I was talking to a couple of friends yesterday. What is it about? We were talking about, because we're going to look at the crisis of capitalism, and of course we can look at the theory, we can look at the contradiction, we can look at how the labors and the capitals are somehow always in conflict with each other. But something that I think is more important is that what are the real life situations that we are facing now? And the other day I was talking to a friend, I mean there's a few of us, and friends do what friends do, basically chatting and talking about a lot of things. So one of the issues that we talk about corruption. Now, corruption is not something directly related to capitalism. You know it? They are capitalism without corruption. I mean, they are a capitalist country with less corruption. But something that's pissed me off is that the corruption in Malaysia, this is recorded, I don't care. But we were talking yesterday that how rampant the corruption is. Because that one friend is actually a businessman. So he said that if you wanted to get a grant or a project from the government, there's always this mechanism for you to do it, as long as you have the money. For example, if you like to get your product or your stuff into Malaysia without having tax or something like that, you just need to pay the customs. I'm not making accusations. This is what he told me. One of his relatives are somehow working in customs departments. He said that, obviously you started off as a very principled man. But the thing is, every day somebody's going to come to his office and put the money on the table. Take it or leave it, it's okay, I'm just going to put it here. And I'll go out. It's okay, we have no obligation to do it. So I'm just going to put the money back. So this happens every day. Slowly and eventually, it's a life struggle out there. There's a lot of things that you have to pay, cars and house and education of your kids. Then you start to take a little bit from there, and it's become a kind of a practice. Now, not just that, I mean, on higher levels, for instance, if you are working as a minister, this is again what he told me, as a businessman, who engage in this particular kind of things, that for you to be able to get the project, you have to pay the certain individuals. What are the rates? How much you have to pay? He said it depends, but usually it's close to 100 million. So this really suddenly for quite some time. 100 million is not small. And this is actually a money that you give to one specific individual. So then the other friends happen to be also quite active in helping the single mother. You know, there's a child kids or something like that. Helping the child kids, right? This is the one run by Ben Zali or something like that. Okay, it's one we go to Child Kid Road and something like that. There's a new program there, they teach the homeless kids, some sort of homeless kids if you like. Try to educate them, try to teach them some kind of free lessons. And also their mothers lah. I mean, they want to engage their mothers and try to educate them. So one of the friends actually told me one of the stories. He said, this single mother, and it's always the same story where they coming from kampo, they come to the city, and then the husband left them in a way. Fuck guys, you know. The husband's always the bad guy, which is again very sad. I don't know why it worked, but it makes me even sad. And okay, the way they rent the house, I mean, they're not purely homeless, but they rent the house by day. So if you'll be able to afford it that day, you'll be able to find a place to live. But if not, you and your kids will be have to sleep on the floor. Slightly emotional now. I hate it. But I mean, he explained to me what happened. I mean, this kind of mothers keep on like. So the thing is, I mean, if you're able to even rent a place, it's not a homey place. It's a place where there's a papa or something like that. Where next door, what you have is those prostitutes, again, cari makan as well, serving the customers. So imagine your kids, you as a mother, and your kids having to sit in that kind of surrounding. Where, you know, this person having sex and such. And sometimes the landowners have the system where if you can't pay, it's okay. I'll lend it to you, but you have to pay with a very high interest. So looking at this particular kind of stories, it's kind of really makes me sad, but at the same time, make me realize that when I do this, or whatever it is that I do, I have to take it seriously. And I hope the same thing with this class. Again, I'm not sure why you come here. Again, there's so many intentions and motivation that why you are here. Some is just you have nothing else to do. It's a Monday night and you got no classes, the whole day. Just came here to meet your friends and maybe have some free foods in the back. Some of you really want to learn, but then just for the sake of learning it. But also I think maybe at the time you walk from your place to this particular class, I mean, these are the things that are being discussed in this particular kind of historians, thinkers, and economists. When Marx, I mean, if you remember last sessions, Marx was writing Das Kapital in a very angry tone. Well, he is angry, yes, because he sees the poverties every day. On his way to library, the British Library. I mean, this kind of thing should actually give us kind of a motivation. Like, this is a kind of a focus. I remember when last two sessions, I can't remember. I was really tired. I mean, I'm not trying to brag or whatever. This is just a thing that I wanted to share with you because I think I'm not a teacher. Yeah, I'm also your friend in a way. I just got back from Kumaman, like 5 hours in a bus. I mean, I'm not driving, but still, it's quite tiring in a way. And I got there at TBS, I think around 6, and I have to carry all the books because I have to carry my books from Kumaman to KL, and also my bags, and also my stuff. Cramping myself in the LRT, crowded, so smelly, and everything. Going to KL Central, then wait there, having my own small lunch, and then from KL Central now go back to UIA, go directly go back, and somebody pick me up. And I was really tired while waiting for Dini. There's no Dini here. While waiting for Dini, I was really tired. I'm trying to curse myself, and curse not the organizers. No. I'm cursing in a very abstract sense. Like, why am I doing it? Again, the numbers are sometimes low, there are not many people come, I'm working on the slides. Like, you know, this slide is not easy to make in a way. But then, when I was like cursing myself and cursing a lot of other people, abstract people, it's like abstract focus, there's no name, it's just abstract people. I noticed this is one guy, who was wearing a baju Melayu. I remember it's a golden baju Melayu. Like, look gold, but it's a golden baju Melayu. He was riding a bike, and he also actually, you know, pijak the tin. He was connecting the tins. Then I was like, okay, when I'm complaining, while this is 7 or maybe close to 8, he's still working and collecting all the cans. So, this is the context that I'd like to bring you back to this, why we started off the course. Is to not look at the economy as a kind of a running up numbers, statistics, and these philosophical discussions. At the end of the day, these things, at the end of your minds, how is it going to benefit the poorest among us, if you like? And for the last 6, this is the 8th class, right? For the last eight class, I realized that I've been doing a lot of talking. And at the end, at the middle of it, I'll do some video presentations. Not me doing presentations, lah, but I'll show you some videos. Again, I'm going to show you another video where you can actually see the... you know MCM, Milik Ethiopia, Milik Siapa? Have you looked at the video? It's a Malaysian production, by the way. MCM, you know the... You know MCM? The one that we learned last lecture? MCM is money. And creating capital and then make more money, right? Mm-hmm. So that particular formula is being used to analyze how the properties industry in Malaysia. That director, the producer was Kia Mengbun. He's some sort of a friend. So I'm gonna give that kind of the perspective later at the end of the lectures lah. But for the next two lectures, I assume we're gonna have another two more organizers, yeah? That's true. Is it true?
Yeah.
It's going to be the lecture 9 and 10. I think I should actually eliminate the video part. There's no more video. This is going to be the last video you're going to watch in this particular series of lectures. And I think I should have more discussions. This is again, because again, I can't force you. There's no marks. I can't like read at you and then you fail and you can't graduate it or whatever. And even if I give you assignments or something like that, if you don't have it, don't want to do it, you can just skip the classes. No one's gonna look for you. But again, the reason why I start with all these sad stories is because to make you realize that if you take this seriously, maybe we can have a proper discussion. Because that's the whole point of the course. It's not just to listen to me talking about all these bullshits. No, because you need to understand these particular concepts and try to relate back to your economic disciplines and economic situations, the one that you learn in your class. Outside this particular course. So again, I was hoping in the end we can do some kind of a discussion. I'm gonna give you some kind of a reading list. Now. It's just an article. I swear to God, I'll not give you a journal like your lectures do. I'll give you a kind of articles for you to look at what are the debates are, and maybe we can have a next lecture. I'll do a bit of a presentation, just very brief presentations about what exactly is the things that we left off. I will focus on criticizing and trying to somehow analyze and discuss about it. I mean, I want more participation from you guys, in a way. So, okay, that's enough of my babbling. This is for me, is it not? Or is it not?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, I know you guys have the slides, but I kind of like put some extra 10 slides to discuss about something else later. But I think this is the last time we stop. Oh, is it not? Anybody can remember where we stopped?
We done the
MCM part, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, it is the after the MCM. So this is basically the profit and wages. What are the profit and what are the wages? So the rate of profit is again, according to Marx, what is profit is equal to what? It's the surplus value. So the rate of profit should mean the rate of surplus value, in a way. So S means surplus value. C plus V is basically the total capital. There's a fixed capital and also the variable capital, which is the workers basically. So out of this particular course, how much profit did you get? How much surplus value that you get? So that's Marx terming the rate of profits. Okay, this is something that you can read for yourself. The principle of competition still applies here. In a sense that in a very long run, this system is okay, we understood it operates in MCM kind of a relationship and attitudes. And I'll explain to you what are the dangers of that. But this MCM relationship, that is, you have money, you buy capital, you make money out of that, to make more money out of that, is actually one of the main components for the competitions to happen. Because if you're in a market and you don't have that kind of a relationship, you won't compete. Somebody call it incentive. But again, does it have to be that case? But again, we can discuss about it later. But because of that MCM relationship, you have a battle of competition. And one of the output of that, one of the impacts of that is that you have a cheapening products. You have more products being produced. Whether it's going to be cheap or not, we'll discuss later. But once you have competitions, people are competing against each other to produce more products. So this allows them to sell their outputs of an individual value less than the current prevailing value. Once you sell that, once you sell your products, and you have to change. I mean, it depends on the market price as well. There's always a tendency to. If you remember one of the last two sessions, where we discussed about Adam Smith and Ricardo, there's always a tendency for the profits to fall. If you remember, Adam Smith said there's a competition. There's a two theses of capital. It's a two thesis of capital competition or something like that, yeah? That profits will tend to fall. Anybody can explain to me why? Don't try? Go. There's a mic. Where is it? Okay, I like this mic because I can actually point to somebody else.
It's the input and output idea. Your competition comes from the output element will come from other capitalists, where it's a race to the bottom. And in a world where labor doesn't increase, the demand for labor will cause you to have to pay higher wages, which pushes it upwards, which also reduces the profits.
Okay, that's true. So Adam Smith suggests two things. If you increase your outputs, you're going to reduce your price. If you reduce your price, you'll be getting less profits in the long run. Rate of profits, not less profit, less rate of profits. But also, if the economy is somehow continuously growing, at least according to Adam Smith, the workers will have greater wages because there's more demand for their laborers to enter the market. So there'll be more wages given to them. More wages means higher cost means less profits again. But again, this is a twofold kind of forces. But again, Marx disagreed with a few bits here and there, but in a very general sense, he agreed that there's a profit that's going to fall. So the way they somehow try to maintain, the capitalists, they try to maintain the profit is by exploiting the workers in two ways. Now, I'll explain to you later, but this is just the general ideas of how it's going to work. And of course, I mean, we haven't reached Ricardo's theory of profits because I skipped the last lecture because I was busy. But here, Marx and Ricardo are on the same page, where even though the rate of profit is going to fall, there's a chance where the profits can increase, if and only if the wages, the subsistence wages or the basic foods and things that make the workers survive, their price are being reduced. Meaning to say, the cost of living for the workers to live is reduced, so they can pay the lower wages to the workers, hence they can actually squeeze that to make it as a profit. I think it's quite important. Okay, this is the characteristic of capitalism in a very general sense. Again, it's nothing that you never know. There's always a surplus product, and this surplus product is being used and exploited by the capitalists. And there's always this driving force, it's the production and the appropriation. I mean, there's always this growth, this force for you to grow the economy and keep on producing more and more. Because of this, Marx realized that this kind of a continuous growth and this continuous commitment to these MCM relationships, they're gonna be crises. These inherently prone to crisis, but it's a good thing because it actually somehow lead to a higher form of production, which Marx said is communism. Because of the crisis itself, the system will collapse, and it will lead to a kind of a different mode of production, different economic relations, which is a higher form of production, which again they call it communism in a way. So this crisis is a blessing in disguise. In a way, it have a very bad impact on a lot of people, but it's also an opportunity. For if the workers are going to rebel, that's where it comes from. Again, this is just some of the basics that we can read. This is the thing that I like you to look at. Okay. Again, even though Marx said that prices or the value of the goods itself will be determined by the amount of labors that's being contributed in the production process. But again, that's the very abstract sense. But how it's being translated in the market, it's still depending on the price. Price, even though it's trying to gravitate back to the natural price, which is determined by the amount of workers and labors expend on the productions. This is the basic formula of how the price are being determined. So you have the cost, C plus P, the capital and also the workers, plus the rate of profit that you want to exploit from the production process. I use the word exploit in a very pejorative sense. Of course, you, capitalists wouldn't think that you are exploiting anybody. But of course, I mean, if you are a capitalist, you can actually, the price will include the cost and also the profits that you want to gain. This is basically it. So you have C plus V equal to the rate of profits. That's what it is. The general rate of profits is actually calculated by Marx as C, the surplus value, the rate of surplus value, if you like, as C over C plus V. With C means surplus value, C and capital is, C and V is basically the cost. The cost that's required in the production process. So there's a capital and there's a workers. Okay, that's, this formula will be used in look at what are the, how the prices begin to occur. But just bear in mind for a while that when you mention general profits, when you mention profit as this signs, it's referring to this particular formula, C plus over C plus V. Okay, there's a different, this is again in the I think it's capital text, capital chapter 2. But this particular kind of formula, you can actually play around with it in a way to somehow express it in different terms. For example, the profit is basically C over C plus V, but also if you divide the numerator by V, in a way you can actually get this particular. This is basically, okay, why do you divide by V? It's a kind of a try to look at the rate of profits per social, how do you put this, social, it's per the total total amount of labors. It's trying to look at the rate of profits vis-a-vis to how the labors are on the ground. Okay, I'll explain it later, but just, if everything is divided by V, you can get a different formula. That is, I can't really see, because I have to stay here. So you have this, C over V and C plus V plus 1 over V. Try to do the math for a while.
No, you write it up.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
that's true. I have this. Okay, so there's a C plus V. So when this is basically times...
it's equals to...
How do you put this? Huh? C plus V, my mind is very slow. Like that.
Sure.
No, it's actually divided by V, sorry. So you mean if you divide by V, so your time is 1 plus 1 over V. Yeah, that's how it works. Right?
Yeah.
Then you kind of like intersection this in a way. Okay. Okay, so my math is really bad, but this is what I copied from the Das Kapital book. And I kind of understand when I was on my way here, in a way. So yeah, anybody didn't get the formula, by the way? Anybody can explain the formula for me? No? Can you explain to me for a while? Because my maths is a bit slow. I know it's plus V over here. So you have S over V times 1 over 2. So that's V, right? Right. No,
that's not the easiest way to explain it.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Then you have to like, maybe they take it.
Okay, this is a very commune thing. So, yeah, I'm the stupidest when it comes to maths. And not just me, no, Marx as well. By the way, this is not being done by Marx. When it comes to mathematics, he let angles do it for him.
Bro, use the blue marker.
So, Marx is the theoretical part, and angles is the mathematical bits. So he's my angle, I know it. So I got a few marks today. Sorry? Did I copy it wrong?
Yes.
I need to check the speech. pretty sure I was right. Theoretically, I was right.
It's
right, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Can you explain it to me?
It's right or it's the same?
Yeah, it's the same, exactly.
You're missing a V over here.
No, it's exactly the same. The thing is, I mean, okay, this is the final formula for the mathematical equation. But now, what does this particular things mean? This is basically the rate of surplus value. Per value, per the workers. How much you get the surplus value out of the workers itself by abandoning the capital part. You see? So that is, this led to what you call as the S. Right? Yeah, that's what I, you never say that, but I can say that just to actually put it different. And the C plus V is actually the amount of, it's the, we call it the composition of capital to the workers. Meaning to see, in the production process, how much capitals and how much workers and what are the ratios between the two. Okay? So meaning in the production process, I'll repeat that again, C over V is a kind of a ratio to look at what, how much C are being used and how much V are being used and what are the ratios between the two in the production process itself. It's an organic composition of capital. So this, we can actually make it as Q. Because this is what it meant. The first one is that the social surplus value per the amount of workers that's involved in the production process, and this C over V is basically a ratio between capital and the workers involved in the production process. The organic composition of the capital, the composition between capital and the workers. There's a Q here. So in a way, we can actually change the whole formula into S1 over C. Am I right? Yeah. It's basically S over Q1 plus 1. Right? Okay, that's the final formula, which again I now understand. So this is basically, okay, why do we have this? Okay, just bear with me for a while. Why do we have this particular thing? Because this particular formula, due to the competition of economies and everything, this bit will be somehow going up and down, and we'll see the impact later. So again, this is the rate of profits, which is equal to the number of the social rate of surplus value. The rate of surplus value based on the social means the workers in a way, and over the composition of capital plus one. Okay, this is about the business cycle. So during the one of the inherent characteristics of capitalism, it's from the crisis. Some would call it business cycle. That's what we learn in the modern economics model. But back in those days, at least Marx said that economics will somehow have this kind of a fluctuation patterns. And during the fluctuation patterns, the wages will be either increased or decreased. Again, this is based quite similar to what we learn in business model. Like, you know, when the economies are booming, what happens is that you have more productions, more demand for labors, and more wages. And when economies are recessing, there's a kind of a repression of the wages and everything. So that the way he frames it is a bit different. He said that actually workers are divided into, there's an industrial reserve army, and there's an industrial active army, I think. Is it the word active that was being used? So what is this industrial reserve army? Because again, the way he framed crisis is that it's a blessing in disguise. And he was having, he said, he had a revolution in mind. That's why he used the word army. So when he said individual industrial reserve army, he was talking about those laborers that are unemployed, who are able to work, but unemployed, the workers, the women, and those who are somehow suffered negatively from the economic crisis. So these are the army that we need to somehow create the revolution. That's why he framed it that way. Industrial reserve army. Those who work is the industrial active army. So the movements of wages are said to be exclusively regulated by the expansion or contraction of the industrial reserve army. So when the industrial reserve army means you have more unemployed workers and somehow reflect the wages in the economy itself. And during the expansion contraction is basically going economic recessions and going boom. The impact of that is that the international reserve army will shrink or expand. economic recession, we have more employed workers, so the reserve army will be somehow lower. If we have economic recessions, that means a lot of people unemployed, then we have more army joining the Revolution Guards. He never used the word Revolution Guards, by the way. That's my invention of it. I should write a book about that. Okay, this one, one of the crises that he predicted. Again, this, okay, I'm a bit reluctant to explain this because I don't believe in it. For quite a simple reason. Again, if you look at the recent Marxist debate, much of the Marxists actually have abandoned this. Except few people. One of them is Howard,
the name here, just for your you want to research or whatever. There's a Michael Roberts. The second one is Andrew Clayman.
So, no one's actually framed. Those that we learned before, Ricardo and Adam Smith, never framed that the falling rate of profits actually is a kind of a crisis. Because according to them, it's again, if you know the rate of profits is going to fall, still the capitalism benefits from it. There's no crisis going to happen. But according to Marx, it's when there's a tendency, first in capitalism there's a law, or there's a tendency for falling rate of profits. I am not. This is how you put it, law of tendency for the rate of profits. But again, if you follow the Marxist debate, there's always a debate whether it's a law or it's a tendency. You can abandon the law. If you are abandoning the word law, it means that it could happen, it could not happen. It's not really a necessary case. I mean, it's not a necessary thing to happen. It's just that there's a certain force in capitalism that actually lead to that kind of a situation. But it's not necessarily will lead to crisis. I'm the kind that believe that it's rather a tendency, but it's not really a proper law where when you have this, it's going to explode into a crisis. I'm just going to skip this one. I'm going to go with it. This is basically expand, and then work, revolution, blah, blah, blah.
The credit system.
Okay, I'll get into the credit system later when we look at the... I changed the slides a little bit. So at the end of this, we're going to look at the contradiction of money. Then we'll get back to the credit system. This is the tangent of profits I want to look at. Okay, now assume a given social rate of surplus value, S1, which is basically in the formula that we have.
This is the formula that we have, remember? It's S1 over Q1 plus 1. Q plus 1, not S1. Which is basically equal to the rate of profits. What is S1? What is S1? It's basically the social rate of surplus value. The other one is the organic composition of the capital itself.
So, because of me, this explained in the last two slides, but in a very competitive economy, capitalists have to make choices because they have to actually increase their production process. So they either have invest more in capitals, I mean to say include more machines, to make it more cheaper, when they include more machines, what happens is they're going to cut off the workers. The second thing they can do is that they exploit the workers even more. That is to say, the workers will be somehow forced to work longer hours. Then they can produce more outputs in the way. That's happened in Indonesia last time we see in the documentary. But those things somehow, even regardless of whether they go both ways, there's a tendency for the rate of profits to fall. Marx allowed a sharp growth of prices. So for the rate of profits so far, what's going to happen to somehow? How is it going to happen? I mean, mathematically speaking, what's going to happen? Q must go up first, right? Yes, Q must go up. What is Q again? Q is basically C over V. How Q going to go up? When you have C more, when you have more capital. Or you have less V. Again, it works at the same time. When you have more capital and more machines are being introduced, less workers are needed. So then you have greater Q in a way.
But see, the capitalist doesn't actually go with that particular directions. What is it going to do? What is it going to do? It's going to actually exploit more of the time of the laborers, right? So how does it actually fall into this? Remember, S1 is equal to amount of surplus value out of the workers, right? So they have the same number of workers, but they force them to actually work longer hours. So they can extract more values, more surplus value from the production process. Because of that, this can actually increase as well, in a way. So they have two kind of directions here, in a way. So this is the first contradiction of capital. You're competing against this, because if this is the case, if capitalists are opting for this particular mode of, this particular kind of directions, the workers are, at one point, the workers are, there's more production, but the workers are not improved, there's no demands, and again, it goes back to the same problems. If you are somehow trying to reduce the number of costs by investing on the capital, again, at the same time, the workers are still there, and they're not actually improved anyway, and you are increasing the industrial reserve army, in a way. So, this tendency for the fall of profits to happen somehow lead to the workers being more and more marginalized. And this lead to a crisis in the sense that this particular industrial reserve army will somehow tend to actually revolt and potentially overthrow the system in a way. So this is the choice that I mentioned just now. You can actually reduce the value of labor power, you can actually extend more exploitation, so these are the kind of influences. So it's not definite, and this is what I mean by it's not definite. There's always a way to deal with this. There's a tendency for the workers to revolt, but there's a way, it depends on which country, depends on which kind of a context environment. These four factors always interplay with each other for the capitalists to counteract the negative impacts for them in a way. So they can either, like, invest on cheapening the cost of standard of living in a way. But again, this is just temporary measures. You can't avoid it in the very long run. There's always this kind of a contradiction. This conflict of interest between the capitalists who wanted more profits and the workers who are not being paid